Today is July 28, 1997. I'm Patricia Stein, here to interview Jetti Rosenzweig, born Zuckerman in Deerfield Beach, Florida, United States. The tape is in English. This is Patricia Stein here to interview Jetti Rosenzweig, born Zuckerman, on July 28, 1997, in Deerfield Beach, Florida, in the United States. The interview is in English. Good morning, Mrs. Rosenzweig. Can you give me your name and your name at birth and the city and country of your birth and how old you are today?
My name is Jetti Rosenzweig, and my maiden name is Zuckerman. I was born in Poland, Kraków, August 22nd, 1917.
Where did you grow up?
In Kraków. In Kraków, yes.
How many people lived in Kraków?
In the whole Kraków, about, before the war, it was maybe 350,000. And Jewish people was 65,000.
Did most of the Jewish people live together in Kraków, or did they live dispersed amongst the population?
They live all over. They live all over. Look, a lot of them, they live in a Jewish section. They call it Kazimierz. But not all they can fit in this place, so they used to live in Kraków, all over, yes.
How did most of the Jewish people earn their living in Kraków? How did most of the Jewish people earn their living?
Earn their living. Look, they have different income, you know. They were all kinds. They have stores, they have, you know. I cannot tell you. All kinds of income. It's hard to tell you.
Did most of them, did they trade with each other, or did they trade with the general population?
With the general population. My father used to have a store with sewing machine, with all kinds of machine. So we have customers, all kinds of customers. Not only Jewish customers, only the Gentiles. So I can tell you only about my father. I cannot tell all. They have the Jewish people and other, they have stores, a lot of stores. This was a big city, so it was a lot of stores in the city. So it was a very nice life in Kraków before, for the Jewish people, even for the Jewish
people. How many people were in your family?
In the nearest family, I had four brothers and me, and my father, and mother.
What were the names of your parents?
My father was Joseph Hirsch Zuckerman. My mother was Zofia Zissel Zuckerman, maiden name Zimetbaum.
And your brothers' names?
My brother, the elder was Mojżesz Juda Zuckerman. He was an engineer. He studied in Brno, Czechoslovakia. The other brother was Israel Zuckerman. He was studying in Kraków. He had a degree from high school, business school. And the other brother the same, Henry Zuckerman, Heim in Jewish. And the fourth brother was Itzhak Zuckerman. He finished his schooling after the war in Kraków Polytechnicum. He was architect engineer, yes.
How did your father earn his living? What was the name of his business and where was it located?
This was located in Kraków Podgórze, in the, they call it, I don't know, in English is a marketplace, but this was not on the marketplace. Around the marketplace were buildings, big buildings, and he had a store there. And this was a big store because he has all kinds of machines, sewing machines, for the peasant, the machines, and all kinds, and bicycles, all kinds of things. And he was, you know, and my mother helped him out when we were young. Then when the children grow up, so he was, they were helping my father.
Do you remember the name of the business?
In English, I don't remember. I cannot tell you how it was. Squad Maschen Rolniczych at Doszyczano. How to say this in English? This was a store for sewing machines and how do you call the for the peasants, the big machines, the
industrial machinery.
Yes. And he used to bring them from Czechoslovakia over from and selling them to the peasant.
Was it farming machinery?
Yes, farming machinery. Yeah.
What were you doing before the war broke out? Were you working or were you at school still?
I was partly going to school and partly I was also helping out in the store. Yeah.
What were you still going to school for?
I used to go to a business school, yes, Then for a while, I think for 2 years or 3 years before the war, and then I was helping also in this.
Your family religious?
My father and mother, they were very religious, but the children, they were not, because we used to go to school. We had friends, all kind of friends. We were not strict. We were religious, but not so strict as the older people.
Did you keep kosher?
Oh, strictly kosher, of course, yes. Strictly kosher. But as far to go to shul or something like this, we didn't. My father, yes, and my mother also.
Did your father go to a local shul or did he go to a big
shul?
To
a local shul, yes, nearby.
Do you remember the name of the rabbi there?
Frankel, yes. Rabbi Frankel.
Do you remember any incidents of anti-Semitism that happened to you before 1939? You know, when you were growing up.
Yes. I remember one day my brother came home and he was all beaten up. He was terrible. So he came. We asked what happened. You know, they came over and started hitting him. He came, you could hardly recognize him. This was before the war. Yeah, maybe two years before the war, not long before. Yes, they were anti-Semite. And they didn't take in, you know, Jewish people to the university. That's why my brother had to go to the in order to study, he had to go out of the country to Czechoslovakia, and he was studying there on the Polytechnicum, because they wouldn't take Jewish people in.
And with this situation, did your family talk of leaving Poland or going to Palestine?
It was very hard to go there, because they wouldn't take in Jewish people. Only if you were very, very rich, you had to have sum of money, what it was impossible for us, you know, to have in order to go to Palestine. The English people, they were also not so good, you know. They didn't want us. They didn't want us any place. That's why Hitler had such an easy thing to, you know, for him was very easy to kill us all.
So there was no talk of even trying to go to America or to the western part of Europe?
No, it was very hard. And then my brother established a factory. The eldest brother, he came, he established, so he was working. So for us was not so easy. It was a big family. It was one person too, but the whole family. And we were a close family. One wouldn't go without the other. All of them, we would go, or nobody.
So what changes started occurring? I mean, your brother was beaten up. What else happened before the Germans took over?
What we were talking, we couldn't do anything. The Germans started the war, and after one day they were already in Krakow, and it was starting the whole, you know, what they starting. They start killing and doing this. So we were like in a, you know, we couldn't do anything. We couldn't move at all.
Can you tell me what happened the day the when did the Germans move into Krakow?
The war broke out the 1st of September, 1939, and they came in 3 days later. They were already in Krakow.
And what happened?
They start killing the Jews right away. They start killing. Every day you could hear this one was killing this one, and not one, all the time.
Can you tell me the day that the Germans came into Krakow, where were you?
I was in the apartment with my parents, with my family.
And what did you see or hear when you looked out the window?
So I all the time only the killing and killing. So I couldn't go out even. Where or what? And they even came one evening. They came in the house. They beating up my father. It was a horrible thing.
Can you describe it to me? What happened?
It was terrible. A man came, a German.
They knock on the door?
Knock. They were knocking with the feet. They were banging. And they came, broke in, and they came in and start beating. Who was in the apartment?
What did they come into your apartment for?
Who asked? Just to kill. Just to kill and to beat us up. Yeah, and he was beating my father. He fell down. He was beating me. So one was not seeing the other one, because it was a terrible thing. But
and what were they after in your apartment?
Who was asking them? You were afraid to open your mouth.
Did they take things?
No. They were not. They were just the bunch for beating. And for taking things, the others, they came some other time.
Did you have non-Jewish neighbors?
In this neighbor where I was, on the same floor, were only Jewish people. So they went to every apartment the same they did. And they ran out and was a mess in the whole building.
How did the non-Jewish population respond to this?
Nothing. They didn't look. They were afraid of them. They shouldn't get killed also. So they keep for themselves. They didn't do anything.
So once the Germans moved in, what did you have to do? What did they tell you?
Every day was a note. You have to go there, and you have to work for this. So every day was something else. One day you have to put on the Star of David. They should know that you are a Jew. The other day was an order. You have to go to work here, and every day was something else.
How did this affect your father's business? And your brother's working.
The business was closed. Who could go to the business? We forgot about the business. We didn't have nothing, money or nothing, food. It was. And when you go, you went to the bakery for a bread. So there was a big line, and of course, where the not Jewish people. So they threw you out because a Jew couldn't get anything on the end of the line. You could stay 2 hours, then you couldn't get nothing. It was... I'm sorry I talk so badly, because I'm nervous. And I, you know, when you start reminding yourself how it was.
Was there a Jewish organization that formed to try and help the Jews with this situation?
Look, in the beginning was nothing. Later on, when they established the ghetto, because this was not, we were not in the ghetto in the beginning. We were in our apartment. We have a very comfortable apartment. When they established in 1941, I think, or 40, I cannot remember, the ghetto, so we had to move into the ghetto. So we were squeezing in one apartment with two, maybe five,
Families.
Families, oh, you see? Families. So then they organized that in the ghetto. We should get something, some food, some, you know, it was different. It was not good, but it was terrible. We couldn't move in the apartment. It was terrible. To cook, it was terrible. And you, my father was religious, and it was once a kitchen. So my brother, he had a factory. So somehow he could, you know, through the factory, he got a small oven, you know, and we put it in the place when we had our, you know, the, when we, where we live. My mother should cook there because it was not kosher there, you know, because he wants to have kosher. So he tried till the end to have the kosher, you know, the kosher food.
Now, where was your brother's factory?
In this was on the suburbs on in Krakow.
How did your brother manage to keep his factory open?
Because he had a partner, he was not Jewish. So the he could, you know, he for the wife, he took over the factory. But he didn't take over because my brother was the whole, who was, you know, managing the whole business. But this, he was on the, you know, how to say?
The letterhead, he was the front.
The front, yes. So that's how he could manage something.
What was the name of your brother's company?
Panstar, the name was Panstar. Like a man from steel, a Panstar, a man from steel, yeah.
Did you have to register anywhere so that they knew that you were there?
Yes.
When was this?
We had to register almost every day because we had to go to work. So you register, you come, you register, here you register, all the time.
Did you have to give your address?
Not sure, yeah.
Did you ever try and think of hiding or?
You couldn't hide, where? You couldn't hide. They were coming at night to, you know, whenever they wanted, they come in, they are there, and they were doing whatever, they took everything, what they wanted. Look, the German, what they did to us is unbelievable. Besides, they kill us, they make us for nothing. Like
Tell me the worst incident that happened to you before you went into the ghetto. Can you remember something that stands out in your mind?
It was in the ghetto, not before the ghetto, in the ghetto, because in the before the ghetto it was a very short time only we were in our apartment. But in the ghetto, one day they surround us because it was they said will be how do you say this? They were taking people to
deported
for the taking out to for work or they said so, but they took us to they took the people to Belzec to you know to those death camps. So I was standing on the street. And I wanted to find out something, what's going on. And in 1 minute I saw a German was on the in a car with a gun, and I was shooting to people, and he was shooting to me, but the car was moving. So instead of killing me, he killed another man next to me. He was standing on the... So this was a moment where I couldn't do anything. I was just staying and waiting. He should kill me. That this was not the worst, but okay, this was one of the...
When did you hear that you were going to have to live in a ghetto?
When? One day they put up a sign, and this day you have to take out whatever you have, the things, and nothing, not the furniture, only the little things, and go to the ghetto.
How much time did they give you?
A few hours. Cannot remember. A few hours. Anyway, you cannot take too many things, so it wouldn't take too long.
What were people saying when they heard this?
What could they say?
What did your parents say?
Look, they were so upset, we couldn't even talk to each other. What we could say? We are numb. I remember couldn't even cry. I couldn't cry. I was like a, stove, something. I didn't know if I was still living or I was alive or I was dead.
Were your brothers, were all of you still living in your apartment together?
Yes.
So what happens? We
we took together with the things, whatever we could, and we took, my brother had a, from the factory, he took something, we should put the things on, and we went to the ghetto there.
And did they tell you where you were going in the ghetto?
No, in the ghetto they said, wherever you wanted, you can go. I had a friend, she had an apartment there. She took us in, and so we were with, not only us, but they were maybe five, families. In this apartment were two rooms and a kitchen, three rooms, maybe five families.
You had to share a room with another family?
Yes, oh boy, unbelievable.
Were they the same kind of people as yourselves, or they were different?
All kinds, but I cannot complain. They were very nice, really exceptional as people. So we lived together.
How did your family feel that first day in the ghetto? Can you describe it to me?
I cannot describe it because it was indescribable. How can you?
Where did you get food from?
Food. Look, people, how it is. They starting, they have little businesses, and they should make a living, So my brother had a factory, so he used to go still to the factory somehow. He got a paper from the German. He could go out from the ghetto for a while. So the factory was very good, so he made money. So as far as money we had in the ghetto, we could buy food. But it was very hard to get, the food.
But did his partner help him from outside?
Yes. The partner, even after, we went out from the ghetto, we were in concentration camp, he used to send through a, Polish person. He sent us some money. We should buy some food. But in this time, my father was already, they took him. And my mother.
Can you describe what happened with your father?
My father was, they took him from the ghetto, and it was, wysiedlenie, how to say. They took him to Bełżec, to the death camp. And what happened there? He didn't come
back. What were the circumstances under which they took him?
It was terrible. They beat him up and took him.
In the street, or they came to your apartment?
They came to the apartment. I saw him the last time when they hit him on the head and it took him.
Why did they take him and not somebody else?
Because he didn't have the papers, the right papers. You know? They didn't give him because they said he's too old. He had 56, he was 56 years old. So the Germans said he's too old already and took him. And my mother was still with her. No, she went hiding. We put her somewhere because we knew they would take her. But my father didn't want to go to there. So they took him. And my mother was, when this was over, we took her back. She was with us in the ghetto.
How did you get, did you have running water and electricity in the ghetto?
It was in the ghetto, yeah. This was an old building, but still they have running water and electricity.
And you had to pay for it?
Sure.
Was the ghetto open? Could you get in and out?
No, it was closed like in a jail.
So
only you had to have a permission if you wanted to go. If you have to go, you had to have a special permission to go out from.
Did you ever go out, or you were had to stay inside the ghetto?
I don't remember if I have any business, but my brother used to go every day to the factory. One brother, and the two brothers, they went. They had to go to work.
The
German, they took, yes, outside, wherever they sent them. Wherever they sent them, who knows where.
And did you have to work?
I have to also, they sent me also.
To where?
All kinds of work, all kinds. Wherever they sent me, I went. I remember once my brother said, my elder brother said, you know what, I will find somebody and pay a woman. She should go and you should stay home 1 day or 2 days, because I said I wouldn't make it anymore. I cannot. So I was, not such a strong person. So he paid her, my elderly brother who had the factory, and a woman went. I didn't go, but she went under my name, and I was staying home.
This is the end of tape one. Rosenzweig, you were saying about the work. Was there anything specific that you kept on doing? Work-wise.
In the ghetto.
Yes. What work? I mean, did you work for a factory?
Not in the ghetto. No. They sent me to all kinds of work in the ghetto.
When you said that your brother had to pay somebody, what kind of work were they going to send you to? That you just couldn't?
The worst. What you can imagine, nothing. Just take from here to put it here, from there to put it here. I should suffer. This was only the seal. What was for them, to the German, was nothing.
What rules did the Nazis bring in for you to live under? What kind of rules and conditions?
What kind of rules?
Yes.
About what, the rules?
I don't know. Did they bring out a list of things that you could do or you couldn't do?
They have any rules to us. Whatever they wanted, they did. Today they thought that we should do this. We should suffer. Nothing else.
Not that you could walk on the pavement, that you couldn't, that you could come into the, nothing like that.
I cannot tell you. What do you mean, in the ghetto? Look, we have hours what we can walk out, or could go out, hours what we couldn't go out, because they start shooting. They could come, you know, in the middle of the night. They could come in the apartment and they were looking for something. You didn't know for what. Just to make you, you should get scared. This was the only thing for them.
Were any of them ever kind or?
I didn't find a kind German. Never. Only Schindler. They were not talking to you. They were not talking like people talk. They were shouting. They were killing you with their voices. They were shouting so that they didn't come in the apartment just coming. They were, you know, with the boots. You know, they were hitting the door. It's unbelievable to describe what brutal people they were.
What did they form a Judenrat? In
yes,
the
in the ghetto was a Judenrat.
What did it do?
They were trying to help us. But every day they have different rules. They broke. Today you have bring me so many people, you know, for this, for that. This was the only thing what for the Judenrat. They need the Judenrat.
Who were the people in charge of the Judenrat? Do you remember their names?
One name I remember, because he was with us in the apartment that he was living. Such a wonderful person, and he couldn't take it. So they put him in jail, because he couldn't take it. He got sick of this, what they wanted from him.
What was his name?
Bieberstein.
Lieberstein?
Yes, Bieberstein.
What did they want him to do?
I don't know exactly what, but you know, the worst thing, what he should bring so many people for this, so many for all kinds of things. Exactly, I don't know.
But because he was living in the apartment with you, do you think that you got better attention or privileges?
He couldn't do anything for anybody. And they were the nicest people, the nicest what you can ever see. Yeah.
So what and happened to him?
He got sick and he couldn't do anything more. So then after a while, somebody else took over. And then because he went to jail, they put him in jail because he couldn't do whatever they want from him. So he was in jail and then he got sick. And I don't know if they killed him. This I don't know. I don't remember what happened. Anyway, he's not alive.
Was there only one ghetto in Krakow? Was there only one ghetto? Or was it divided?
One ghetto. The ghetto was Krakow Podgórze. This is Podgórze. This was like part of Krakow. A part of Krakow.
What did the Jewish police do?
Pardon me?
The Jewish police. Were they Jewish police?
Police? Yes. Oh, yes. It was the Jewish police. So they were helping them out. Look, they were
helping the Germans?
To the Germans, yes. Because they thought this way they would survive. And the family, they could survive, and the family also. Though they wanted to please them, some of them, they were terrible. Some of them, they were overdoing.
Can you give me an example?
Beating up people, you know, they help the Jewish people. But in the end, what happened with those, they killed them all. They shoot them all, the policemen, what they working for them. That's how it was.
Can you describe to me, were there any actions that happened in the ghetto?
But it was so quiet about it. So I found out many years later about it. It was in Krakow, a resistant party. I know very well some of them. They were my friends. And they were working in this resistance. And it was one day I heard about it. And it was all over in the paper. In the war. It was in a cafe house. They knew a few men, you know. They knew that at this time a German, this and this German, he would show up in this cafe. So they went there and they were throwing grenades, and they killed a few Germans. So they took the young men. In concentration camp in Plush, where I was, and they were shooting them all. It was a few, I don't know, five, six. And one of them I knew very well, this was my friend. And I didn't see this, but I heard that he was not waiting till they shoot him. He started running and they shoot him. Yeah. And he was one of the heroes.
Were there any Jewish or non-Jewish organizations outside of the ghetto who tried to help you, who tried to help the people inside the ghetto?
They were, but in this time nobody knew anything. They even talk, and I found this in a book, that my brother, my eldest brother, he was also in this organization, and he was doing something, but I didn't know anything. This was very dangerous even to talk about it. But I was reading a book. I had the book, and it said, they were mentioning my brother, that he was in this organization underground, yes.
Can you tell me some of the activities that went on in the ghetto? Were there shuls that were going on in the ghetto?
The shul?
Yes. Was the people...
This, I don't know. This really, I don't know. Look, religious people, my father used to daven, and, you know, for himself, he didn't go to the shul. The shul were closed. They were making from the shuls for the, you know, horses, and they were using this for other things, the German. No, you couldn't
and
go to.
Was there any education, like were there lectures, or yes, what did they do with the children?
Yes, they established something for the children, and they used to go, but this was, all, you know, underground. You couldn't go openly. No.
Did you ever help out with that?
Yes, sometimes, yes. If I knew that somebody, so I was taking, the children, they were afraid of the children, I don't know, somehow, they were not children anymore. They were grown up, because they have this feeling that something is very bad. Something, they, you know, children. Some, it was terrible with the children, because you knew that they are helpless. They couldn't do anything, and we couldn't do for them nothing. Some, you know, they took out, you know, one of them. You know, of a million survive, because they took them out. And I knew, I have a friend, she's in Israel, her son survived, because she has somebody. This one came from far away from, you know, and she came and she took the boy from the ghetto, and she kept
a non-Jewish person.
Not Jewish person, yes. Yeah. The same thing, my sister-in-law from, you know, my brother's, no, wife, she also survived, after the war, I found out, I didn't know, because they married after the war, that she survived with her father, mother, and from Ukraine, you know, a Ukraine person, and they were the worst. They took them and they survived. They put them some in hiding and they survived the war. Yeah. So some people, very, very few, but yeah, and some, you know, and some, the Gentiles, they took, and they took the money from the people, and I have also, you know, I know the people, they have money, so they gave them the money, they should do something for, they took the money, and then they tell the German, that the, and they killed him right away, and I know where, even they killed them on the spot, yeah. All kinds of things.
Were you ever asked to work in the resistance?
No, no, they never ask anybody. They never ask anybody.
So
I didn't hear about it, no, no.
Were there any Christians in the ghetto or anybody who wasn't Jewish?
Nobody, but it was one drugstore. It was a drugstore, I have a book, a special book. A very nice man, a Gentile man, and he had this drugstore, and he said, because they said it was came an order, he should move out and leave the drugstore. He said no, and somehow he got the drugstore, and he was in the ghetto, one Gentile, and people used to come to him. I have the book, so I know exactly how it happened. They hide, you know, money there, and they used to come for talking about, you know, about this whole story. So very nice person. So after the war, you know, they invite him here to New York and make a big fuss about him because he was such a nice man. Yeah, but so he was till the end, he had the till they liquidated the ghetto. His name was, I don't know, I don't remember, but not in this moment I can't. Yes.
Did any of you, besides what happened to your father, did any of your brothers or yourself or your mother suffer any brutality under the Nazis?
Look, my brother, they took him from, because he, when it happened, they took my father, and we knew what happened the same to my mother. So he has, we didn't know about it, but after they took my brother, they killed him, they took him to the, you know, prison in Krakow, that he had somebody who make papers, the Irish papers. They should go, you know, as not as Jew, they should be outside the ghetto, but it didn't work. Because somebody gave out this whole thing, so they took my brother and his partner, and they took it, they put him in the jail, the worst jail, and they killed them. My brother, this engine, this one, and from the factory.
Well, how did, what do you know exactly what happened to your brother?
Exactly, I don't know. I know that he put him in the, what is the jail, the worst, in Krakow. Montelupi, they call it, the jail, and they probably they tortured him. What kind? You know?
Did you hear?
I was not there. But
did you hear that he'd been arrested?
That what?
That he'd been arrested. That he'd been taken into jail.
I know. Of course, I know.
And
I,
what did you?
Because
try?
His partner, the Gentile, he was there. So he told me they took him because he made the papers, and
they took him from his factory.
From the factory, yes.
And did you have time to try and go and get him out? What happened?
I was doing whatever I could, but who can talk to them? I went to a Jewish man who was working for Gestapo. You know, in this time, Jewish people, they were doing this because they were thinking maybe they will survive. So he said, don't you, why are you so worried? He will go to a concentration camp, he will work. Well, don't go home, don't be afraid. I knew this is, I wanted to give him money. He should do something. You couldn't do anything.
When was this? What year was this?
This was 1943.
The beginning of 1943?
September or October, something like this. Yeah, October.
Of 1943.
43.
And when was your father taken?
1942. The 4th of June, I remember. June, this I remember. June 42. The 4th of, I cannot, I'm so nervous. June 4th, 1942. This I remember.
So what happened after this, after your brother? How long was he there for, do you think, in the jail?
I don't know.
You lost all contact with him after that?
Who could know? This was impossible.
Did your other brothers try and do anything?
For a man, it was even worse to show his face. I could go. I went everywhere, whatever I could, because for a man, they would right away take him.
Now, at this point in 1943, what were the conditions like in
the ghetto?
In the ghetto.
Horrible. Horrible.
Can you describe to me, like, the food situation, or had they started with selections?
Oh, I don't have strength even to talk about it. It was a selection, not a selection. It was a, how do you call, they took maybe 7,000 people to the camps, to the death camps. So they, in the morning, they surrounded us again, and they said we should come there and there to the place. But I didn't, I said to my mother, and I was with my mother and one brother. So he said, you know what we should go do? We should go to, this was his idea, to a policeman whom we know, maybe he could help us. And we went there. So he said, stay here. I have my parents, and we will do something. And he took us and his parents, and he took us through. People are all around, and somehow with him, we went through, out from the ghetto, to a place what we were waiting. Till was the end of the selection, not the selection, they took out all the people.
Deportation.
The deportation, yes. So we were waiting almost the whole day after this, so we came back to the ghetto. So we saw I was with my mother and this brother. So we survived, in this time we survived this deportation.
Did they come searching for people?
No.
Or they had their 7,000?
No, after they had so many people, so they didn't search anybody. So
was there anybody from your apartment who went with that?
What?
Was there anybody who was in your apartment who went with that deportation?
Yes, yes, yes. They went also. They took them.
And then what happened? Did the Germans come and go through their things, the people who had left?
No, after this, they were, for them it was enough, because they have so many people already they took out. They were waiting till the next time. So we were for this time being, we were safe for a while. So we were.
And then what happened? Did you have to re-register to be in the ghetto?
Yes, sure. We had to register. And then after, maybe a few months later, was the liquidation of the ghetto. So.
Now, in this time, before the liquidation of the ghetto, were you working?
Probably, yes. Look, I don't remember what I did. I know that. I live in fear, and yes, for my mother, for probably I was, yes, I was, what I'm talking. I was working, of course. in a place I was sewing something, buttons to the uniforms, yes.
Was it at a particular factory?
This was not a factory. They established this, so they put people because they were still in the ghetto. They wanted to, we should do something, so we were working.
Was it under, was anybody in charge of this?
Yes, some girls, you know, from us or from the German.
You don't remember?
No, I don't remember. We were working there. Till the, you know, the
now liquidation. Can you tell me what made you realize that they were going to liquidate the ghetto?
I didn't know. One day they said, we have to go, because they established the concentration camp, that we have to go to the concentration
Which
camp.
Which concentration camp?
Plaszów. This was nearby.
Were any of your brothers there already?
Yes. Were two brothers there, my sister-in-law, and I was with my mother and with one brother. The other brother was with his wife in the concentration camp.
In
Plaszów. And they were going every day to work to Schindler already. They didn't know who was Schindler in this time, but they got the job, so they used to go. And then we went to the, when there was the liquidation, we went to Krakow, to the concentration camp, my mother, me, and my brother.
How did you know that, how did you manage to go there? Rather than
by foot. Yeah, we had
but
to walk.
When they liquidated the ghetto,
so
what happened? Were you there when they liquidated the ghetto?
God forbid. If I would be there, I would be dead. I went a day or two before because they said we have to go. Who?
They opened the gates of the ghetto?
Yes, because we went out under the German. They were surrounding us, and we went, you know, straight to the concentration camp. When we came there, so the next day, or 2 days later, we heard that they killed all the people who couldn't go because they didn't accept the children. So the mothers, the families who had children, they had to stay in the ghetto. So they killed all of them, and some of these they sent to Auschwitz to gas them, you know. So they killed all the, you know, the rest.
Before you left the ghetto, did you ever need to be hospitalized or need medical treatment?
In the ghetto?
Yes.
No, my mother was, I think, once, but was very dangerous to be in the hospital, but because they used to come in and shoot the people in the bed, whoever it was. They shoot my uncle, my aunt, so many people.
In the hospital?
In the hospital. Because some people, they were hiding. You know, they wanted to maybe, say, they said, maybe it's safe to go to the hospital. So they went to the hospital. Stories.
So now, when you went to Plaszów, what happened? Can you describe to me the day that you went to Plaszów, what happened?
So I went to the, I was in a barrack, you know, with other people, with my mother. And my brother went to another with a man. Then he was starting working also with my brother in the Schindler's. So he used to go, and we were staying in Krakow, Plaszów, with my mother. And I used to go out working. My mother was sick all the time, so she couldn't work. But I have very good friends, the police, so they were looking, you know, through the, she could stay in the barrack. They knew that she couldn't go to work.
What was the matter with your mother?
She had heart trouble all her life. So in this condition, so it was terrible. So she used to go to the hospital there in the concentration, was a
in
little
Plaszów.
Hospital in Plaszów. So she was sometimes staying there, sometimes she was in the barrack. And I used to take a job, what I was working only 2-3 hours, then I was with my mother. So I had friends there, they said, why are you working you could work in the somewhere in the office. I said, I cannot, because I have a sick mother. I have to stay with her. So I took a job, whatever I, you know, I should stay with her. One day, now it, I'm coming, how they killed my mother. Oh. One day I came from this beautiful work, and it was in the evening. And when I came in, maybe 5 minutes later came two women, and they were asking, Jan Kat Zuckerman, where is she? They were calling. So I was surprised. I went to them, I said, what do you want from me? So she said, they said, you have to go to work. I said, to work? I just came, what are you talking? And my mother asked her, please, what do you want? It's so many girls, why you have to take her? You have to go. And I went. When I went out from the barrack, I saw, you know, the police was standing nearby, you know, in lines. I didn't know what happened, but I couldn't ask. So they took me, and I was walking, you know, through the whole camp till the end. They were barracks for the Ukraine people. And they said, you have to clean something, the barrack. And they showed me, you have to go in here. And I went there. When I went in the room, I saw a man, a German, and he looked at me and said, for what you came here? I was surprised. I said, they said I should clean here the room. He said, sit down. So I sat down. And I was sitting, doing nothing. Then he said, ask me, whom do you have in the camp there? I said, I am with my mother. He didn't say anything. Maybe an hour later, he said, you can go. And when I came back, my mother was not there anymore. So the whole barrack was crying. Everybody, oh boy. So I realized what happened. But then they told me, when you went out, they took her right away. And they killed her.
This is the end of take two. You were saying you came back into the barracks. Where had your all the rest of the people in the barracks been while you were sent down to the Ukrainian barrack?
They told me that the policeman came in and took my mother. And my mother, look. And they took her, you know, they were walking. And she was crying, she was, my name she was calling, my name she was, and I was not there, I couldn't help her. And to a place, I know where they keep all the people together and they shoot them. So they shoot them, the next day they brought me things from her, what she was wearing. Probably they took off, she had to take off her clothes. Yeah, and so that's how it was.
When was this?
This was the 44. The date, I think it was 8 of, I don't know exactly, August 8.
1944.
Because you know why? I remember a few days later, they called, somehow they let me know that I am on the list, because I was on the list to go to Schindler with my mother. You know, because I had already there two brothers and my sister. So they were making, you know, we should come there, we should be together. So they put us, Schindler put us on the list, my mother and me. But they killed my mother, and I went by myself to Schindler. This was, yeah, maybe two, three days later, after this, what happened.
Did your brothers know that this had happened to your mother?
No, they didn't know. How could they know? When I came alone, they knew what happened.
Did anybody try and commit suicide?
Yes, I heard. But I was not there, but I heard.
What is, before you left for Plashov, what is the strongest memory that you have of the ghetto, of this Plashov, Krakow?
Plashov or the ghetto?
The ghetto and Plashov. This is before you went to Schindler.
This is what I am telling you. This is what I am telling you. I went to the hell in the ghetto and the Plashov. Terrible. Hell. And I can't, you know, all the time I remind myself, which the commander, he was like a devil. And everybody was so afraid of him, like, because he was shooting to people like to birds, you know. If he didn't like your face, he shoot you. For anything, just because he was in the mood to shoot.
Did you ever, when did you first come into contact with Schindler? When was the first
when
time?
When I came to, when they, with the list, when I came to the Schindler camp, yeah.
So where was Schindler's camp?
And this was, oh boy, how do you, this was in Krakow, but it was on this, not in the centrum, but on the, how do you call this, the place? It has a name, but I don't remember, this minute I cannot tell you. Oh. Yeah. This was a section where all the factories were. Even my brother's factory was in this vicinity. All the factories.
So were you going to live in the factory at this point?
Yes, we didn't live in the factory. We lived next to the factory because we had barracks. Nice
what was
barracks,
the factory's
small
name?
Barracks, only for 25 people. Small barracks. We had not those big, 500 girls were together. He was only 25, and it was clean, and it was nice, and it was small, you know. So we used to live in those barracks, men separate, and we were separate. I was with my sister-in-law, and my brother was in the...
Now, where was this? What was the name of the factory?
The factory, Emil Warn Fabrik. They were making, in the beginning, only the pots and pans, you know. This was in the beginning, but later he established a factory for, you know, for the war, you know, machine, that all kinds of things what he used to work also. And then he built up another place for the other things, not for the Emilvan fabric. This was the start only.
So can you just describe to me the day that you left Plashov and you went to Emilia? Can you describe to me what happened?
To describe how they came to me, I don't remember even.
Did they call your name?
In this time I was, you know, after I lost my mother, I didn't know what was going on even. Probably they came to me and they tell me, come there. They were showing me, otherwise I wouldn't go. Because.
And how did you get there? Did you walk or did you go by
truck? I don't remember.
And when you got inside?
No, probably we went with some because it was too far to walk. No. Probably with those machines, I don't know.
Something. You don't remember?
I don't remember. Not at all. I got there. I know that I got there.
And when you got there?
Crying.
When you got there, what happened?
Oh, they saw me alone. So they didn't even ask.
Brothers were there when you got there?
Yes, my brother, my sister-in-law. So we were all together. Then we were together till the end.
Now, when was the first time that you came across Oscar Schindler?
Right away when I came. He came over. He was a very friendly man. Yeah, he liked to ask, how is the family Zuckerman? Every year he passed by, always asking, how is the family Zuckerman? Yes, and one thing I remember when we were in Auschwitz, because we went through Auschwitz. Before we went to Brindis, we went through Auschwitz, the woman and the man in Grossrosen. So nobody could recognize when we came, you know, from Auschwitz, the girls. So he came over and said to her, how wonderful to see you, that you are already here, in German. Good to see you. This was a very nice thing to, you know, in such a situation. That he said, don't worry, because right away we got some food. So he said, we didn't have what to eat. So he said, don't worry, they will bring you some things to eat. He was a mensch, you know. He was a German. But he once said to my sister-in-law, he said, mit solche Sachen kann man nicht die war nicht winnen. With, you know, with things like what they're doing, we cannot win the war. You know, that's what he said. But still, he was very friendly with the German, because he had to. He said, because of you, I have to be friendly with all those brutal men, with those terrible men, because he wants to be friendly, because he needs them for all kinds of things.
So he really, he didn't want to be friendly
with
the Germans.
He didn't want to, because, look, he was smart. I don't know how good he was, but he was very smart. He knew they cannot win the war.
And he was always good to you. Did you ever have any contact with him other than that time when he said, how's the Zuckerman family?
Yes. After the war, so one of our people, they were making a big party in New York. So, of course, they invite us and invite all the people who were in Schindler. So he was there, and we had such a wonderful time. We were talking about what was and what, he was very friendly, very friendly.
Now, during this time when you were in Emalia, what were you doing there?
I was in, my sister-in-law, she was working very hard. So she said, I mean, they were before us, so they knew how to, where to put me. I shouldn't work too hard because I was not such a strong person. So she was trying. I used to work in an office. I used to work all kinds of work. I shouldn't do anything very hard, you know. So it was, there it was not too hard for me. But still, it was a concentration camp. You never knew what, because Schindler was only in the factory. We had a place, you know, where we did the barracks. So over us was an SS man. He was like a terrible, like Get.
What was his name?
Leipold. He liquidated one, concentration camp, they told us, and came to us. So he wanted to liquidate this concentration camp.
What did he do to you? What did he do to the people?
Look, he tried to do whatever, but Schindler was always telling us, don't do this, don't do that, because he could see this. So he always used to tell us, yeah.
Did you ever have any dealings with this man, this SS man?
One time I saw something, I was very scared. We were sitting, working, you know, all kinds of, I was working a big machine, and they were making those for the, I don't know how to describe this, stanza, if I can, telling you in Polish. War machine, some parts.
Shells.
And this was a very big machine, and I had to be dressed specially to this, and I was working in this. And came a lot of, you know, those German, and looking what I was doing. So he was starting, Schindler, that I am such a wonderful worker, and the best. He wanted, you know, that he had the best workers, so that I am wonderful working, and I hardly knew what I was doing. They told me I should do it, so I was doing so. So it was, look, he was very good to us. What can I tell you?
Can you describe to me what the barracks is, what your day was like? Did you have a roll call when you started in the morning?
Yes.
What happened?
In the morning, we had to go to work.
Who woke you up?
I don't know. Probably there was a person, this I don't remember. So we had to get up and go to work, and we had some places to wash. I think, I don't remember how it was. And one time it was a horrible thing. This had nothing to do with Schindler. It was already, they were talking that the end is near the war. And one night I was sleeping, and I woke up, and I was thinking, oh, the war, not the war, but the world is ending, because I heard bombing, and it was night, but it was like daytime, because it was flying, you know, those, the light was coming, and it was a terrible noise. I didn't know what happened. In one moment came in a man and said, get up and go out this minute from the barrack. How you stay? Don't put anything on. And like I was staying in this water, even without the shoes. I went out with my sister, and we went out. And in a minute, everything was burning. The whole barracks were burning. So we didn't know what happened. So then the next day, they took us to the factory, and we were staying in the factory. It was so many people, 1,000 people, so it was not so easy. Came Schindler during the night, and we didn't know what would happen with us, because the whole barracks, everything, it was, burned out. So we were in the factory, and Schindler came the next day. He was in the night at night there. Then the next day he said, and he took us all together and said, don't worry, we will do something, because look what happened. A big plane, they shoot up a big plane, and the plane fall on the barracks. On the next barrack where I was there, if they put the bar, and the barrack was empty. A week before, all the girls went back to do Płaszów. Otherwise, they were killed. And the plane fell on the barrack, and I was next to the barrack. It was, I don't know, somehow. And he said, and the plane was there. So the next day, he said, if you want, you can go and look around. And we, if he said we can go, so we went with it, and we were looking. The plane was on the ground, everything was burned down, and we saw, I didn't see it, but they said that a pilot was burned down, was laying there, and German came all over, they wanted to see, and they were trying to find out what was happening, what kind of plane it was. This was from Australia. They shoot down
an
this
Australian
plane. Yes. So they didn't know what to do us. So they sent us all to Plaszów back. Look what it was.
And where did you stay in Plaszów?
Somehow in a barrack. At this I don't remember what happened. In a barrack there. But this, we were there not such a long time. Then they make the list. This is the famous list. And whoever got on the list went to bring it.
Can I just, what about the Jewish police? What about that man Goldberg? What do you think about him?
Yeah, they said that he made money on the list. This is what I heard. I was not there. I'm only repeating what other people are talking. Because everybody wants to be on the list. Because they knew this is a good concentration camp and they can somehow survive. So everybody was giving whatever they had. That's what I had. We didn't have anything. We didn't give him nothing. Because we didn't have. But why we were on the list? Because there was a man who established the whole concentration camp in Amalia, in not Schindler, but another man. But I am not cannot get in because it's too long story.
Well, you can tell me.
This was an owner, Mr. Banker, who was the owner of this factory, a mile Warenfabrik. And he was the owner. But when the German came in, he couldn't have the factory because a Jew cannot own a factory. So he took in Schindler as a, how did you call him? Because my husband has also Treuhänder, something like that, who took over. Schindler took over the factory. And he was like an owner, you know, of the factory. And then the banker wanted to establish the camp, because he wanted the factory should exist, you know, and this is how it came to. It's a different story like on the picture, but
You knew this Mr. Banker?
Of course I knew.
From before the war?
No, not from the war. When I was there, I knew him.
Now, he was Jewish?
Yes.
And
he
was...
He couldn't have the factory because he was Jewish. But this was the owner. Yeah. Yeah, of course I knew him. And why he wanted to establish everything, it's so many things. He had a niece, a little girl. He knew it was very hard, a little girl, she should survive. So he was thinking if he would establish, maybe she could survive.
What was her name?
The girls. This I don't remember.
Did he live in the barracks with the rest of everybody?
Yeah, sure. He was like another prisoner, nothing else. On the picture, they showing Mr. Stern, that he was also Mr. Stern there in the factory. It was Mr. Sam, a very nice man. But he has nothing to do with the ownership of this factory. Mr. Banker was the owner. He was like a bookkeeper. He was working there in the office. Yeah.
So Mr. Stern worked in the office and Mr. Banker worked in the office together.
Yes. And Mr. Schindler was coming with everything to Mr. Banker because he was the head of, he knows how, about the business. She didn't know what. He came only to because he needed him. To be on the
be in charge.
Yes, yeah, like this, yeah. Because he couldn't own the factory, only some a German should have. The same my husband had, this is a different story. Okay. The only thing is only because I cannot express myself. In Polish, I could tell you the story better.
Did you have any contact with the policeman Goldberg?
No. I didn't have any, yes, but after the war, I found out that he knew our family very well, and this is the reason that we got in on the list. Otherwise, we wouldn't be there, because he took only people who had money. That's what I heard.
But you didn't know him?
I knew him, but I did never talk to him. In this time, he was a big shot, and I was a very small.
What happened? When you were going to be in Amalia after you were taken to back to Plaszów.
So we were there a while, and then it started with a list because Schindler. Before we went, even he was talking about this maybe months ago. That he has a place because the army, the Russian army was coming near, so the German prepared themselves to go farther into the. They should be not so near to the army, so he went because he was from Czechoslovakia, born, so he went there, and he found a place. And he told us everything, that he found a place and a factory, and he will take us there. But for us, it was like a dream, what he was telling us. We didn't believe him, because he was a German. He said, what he's talking? He would take us? Why should he take us? He would take whomever he wants. But he really meant it. He took those people who were in Amalia.
What do you think, when do you think he changed from being just an industrialist interested in himself? When did you see when he changed to suddenly being interested in saving people?
Look, he changed. I think little by little, I was not all the time with him, but he saw the things what the Germans were doing. So he was thinking, no, I will do something good for them. They wanted to kill them. No. I will do something they shouldn't get killed. Yes. And many times he showed us this. Yes.
In what ways? Can you tell me?
He should give her some more food. Sometimes. He couldn't do too much because it was very hard to get food. But somehow he managed. We get that sometimes something more, some more food. And this word meant
a lot. Did any heads or owners of other camps come to Imalia or to Plaszów that you, like Madrich or Tich?
Yes, they came, but I didn't have any contact with them. No. I didn't have. Look, when they came to the bigger people, to Schindler if they wanted to go to talk over something, not to us, you understand. We were only workers then. Some people like this gold, what is his name? What do you mention? The one?
Oh, Goldberg, no. The policeman?
Goldberg, yes. He was an other man. Somehow he was pushing himself. He was a pusher, so the people were telling us that he was taking money from people. From where could they have money? I don't know. Somehow, he got.
So and people didn't like him?
No, they didn't like him, no. I don't know, I knew his wife. She was all the time with me. She was a very nice person. She was a friend all the time. We never talk about him. She never talked about him. I remember, because I was afraid, I heard in Prussia that they're making a list, and he's taking money. So I went to this banker, you know what I'm telling you, because he was the one, he was the most important person to make the list. So I went to him, I said, Mr. Banker, tell me, are we on the list? So he didn't want to say it. Then he said, are you crazy or something? So I didn't know what what he meant.
But he didn't want to talk about the list.
He didn't want to say anything, yeah.
End of tape three.
Pardon me?
It's the end of tape three. Were there any children in Amalia or in Plaszow?
In Amalia were few children in hiding, you know, they hide them. And it was such a terrible thing because one day we heard in Plaszow, in the concentration camp, there were 350 children. And I knew, even I have a friend, she has a boy, and beside this there was also from the family, my family was also a boy, he was maybe 11, and one day they make a selection in Plaszów, and they select some people, 1 week, the next week. They told me, because I was not in Plaszów, I was in. And they came and took those people whom they selected to Auschwitz to guess them, and they took all the children. And I knew why I knew so good, because my husband was in Plaszów in this time. I was not married in this time. So he said that it was such a... people were so yelling and crying because they saw from, you know, how they took the children. But some of the children, maybe 8 children or 10, they ran away. And you know what they did? They went to the latrines
This was in Amalia or in
Plaszów? This was in Plaszów. They went into the, and they were hiding there. I heard this, my husband told me the story later because I was not there. And they survived, thanks God, those few people, few children, maybe 8 or 10, and the 350, they guess, in Auschwitz. And later, maybe a week later, they came to our camp, to Amalia, and they put us in, you know, I remember we had to stay in line, and came a German, and with Schindler, if not Schindler, they would take us. So Schindler was running like crazy, and he was talking to the Germans. He said, louder, young people, louder. This means only young people are. Well, not true, because in the back were older people. So he was running to the Krankenstube, you know, because there were a few people who were sick.
So what is a Krankenstube?
Krankenstube is like a hospital, little hospital. So he didn't want they should take out those people. So he went there and took this German and took him upstairs. He had a place where he had a lot of vodka, and he gave him so much he didn't know what is it. He was coming and going, and he went out. Yes, so the German went away, and he didn't do anything. He didn't take anybody from our care.
And he didn't take the children?
No, not in this time. But it came an order, and all the children, even the girl, what Bunker established, the whole camp for this child, she had to go. Oh, it was indescribable.
What happened? I mean, did they just tell them that they had to go?
They had to go, yes.
What happened?
So they had to go. And I remember one friend, she had also a girl. So a week before, she took her out and gave her to the you know, Catholic people. And she survived, the girl. Yeah, thanks God. And the other, well, maybe it was 5 or 6 children. And they had to go to Plaszów, and they took her with a whole, you know, with the 350, they took her, took them. Yeah. Yes, yes.
Now, was Gett at this camp?
It's so many stories. Gett was in Plaszów. He was the commander. And it was a time, one day he said, everybody who has anything gold has to give up. So I have something, little things, earrings, okay. But you know, it had a lot of, you know, thing, and he took from somebody else, and he had a lot of gold or things. And they told us, because we were in Brinic, that they arrested him, because they found out that he stole the gold and some other thing from the German, because this should belong to them, but he took it, you know, and put him in jail. He was in jail during the war. But this was the end of the war. I remember one day Schindler came to us. We were in Schindler's camp. And he said, you know what, get this murderer, the Germans were losing the war, and where he was in the jail, the Russian took over, so he was free. The get was free, and it was not far from the camp where we were in Brinice. So Schindler said, he is coming to us to visit me. Get is coming to us to this camp in Brinice to visit Mr. Schindler. So he said, you have to be very careful. He's nothing now, but still he can do something. So be careful, because we were not so there. We could sit, we could do whatever. It was not so strict with Schindler. But when he said, when he is coming, sit, try to do something. He shouldn't see that you are, not working. So when he came, right away he said, what are they doing here? Why you put them not out to do something? So Schindler had to take some people. They should do something outside. Yeah. This was not necessary, but he wanted to please him. He should, he should be quiet. But he was a while, and then he went away. So this was him.
Did you ever have any other experience with Gett when you were in Plaszów?
Yes, one time I remember I was I was working something, I don't know, in... No, this was not working. He gave an order, everybody should go out from the barracks to be on the field somewhere together. And he wanted to count us. I don't know what was the reason. but my mother couldn't go out, so I hid her in the barrack. So, and I was sitting there, because he said everybody should sit down. So we were sitting down, and he was walking, and I heard he was shooting, and I heard this. So I was thinking, he should shoot me also. So I got up and I started running. He could shoot me, but somehow he was not, probably he didn't see me. And I ran to the barrack, and I went to my mother, because I was afraid that he is alone. So he was shooting, then I found out that he shot 10, 15 people. Yeah.
Did anyone try and escape from Plashov?
Yes.
And
they escaped.
Happened?
So they killed, he killed 10 people. Yeah.
Can you describe what happened?
I was not there exactly. This is what I heard, that one or two girls, they have some friends, and a man took them, put them in a, he was going out with some stuff, you know, and he put the girls, or one, I don't know, in a box, and took them out from the Krakow Plush, from them. Then it was an appeal, you know, they took us and they count us, so it was missing. So he was mad, and he said, every second one has to be shot. So he shot 10 or 15 people. This time. Every day was something, every day in Plashov, everybody, every day he shot people.
What is your worst memory of Plashov?
Every day was terrible. Every minute was there.
One that sticks out in your mind. That
no, this one, but it couldn't be worse. When they shoot my mother. And then, you know, I was thinking, who could do this? Because to take me out, I shouldn't be with my mother, because they knew if I would be with my mother, I would go with her. So somebody from the police, probably they were thinking I shouldn't be with my mother. So he sent the man, I don't know till now who was this. I only can, you know, vaguely imagine who, that he probably was thinking if I would be with her, I would go, because I wouldn't leave her alone. So he sent those women, I should go out from the barrack. You understand? And I should be far away. I shouldn't know anything. And still I am not sure who did this.
Did you ever go to Getz's house?
No. No, I never went there.
Did Mengele ever come to your camp?
No. On this, he was in Auschwitz. He was not in Plashov. No. Yes, I was selected twice. In Auschwitz. I remember how it was. And I was afraid because I am small and so slim, and so I was thinking maybe he could take me like a, you know, young. So I was young, but still I was afraid. So I went, I remember, we had to have all the clothes on one hand and naked. So I went there, she took me here by my hand and like squeeze a little bit. He said, this way. So it was a good sign, probably. It was not for that, only for, yes.
Can you tell me what happened when you were sent out from Plashov?
From Plashov?
Yes, from the second time, after Amalia, the barracks had burnt down, then you went to Plashov, and then where did you go from there?
We went from Plashov to Auschwitz. When we came to Auschwitz.
How did you know? How did you know that you were leaving Plaszow the second time?
They set the day, and we should be there on the the place what we should get together. The 300 girls, but we went with 2,000 girls. We went together and put us in the train. And
what happened to the other girls?
The 2,000, I don't know. Some of them, they survived. Some of them, they sent to other camps, you know. And they kept us, the 300, together.
So what happened? You were put on the train, and how long were you on the train?
We came to the Auschwitz, and I remember it was at night, and I heard voices, and they were talking. I heard them talking. Don't be afraid. Now they are not guessing anymore, people. I said, what are they talking? Guessing? What's my guess? You even we knew we couldn't. You know, it was hard to. You know, they are guessing, still guessing. This was 1944. So they took us out, and they put us separate, the 300. I said, what are they going to do with us? And the other they put in a different place. We were staying the whole night and a whole day without food.
What were you wearing?
Still, we had the clothes of what we came, but then they took us to a place. They took everything what we have, and they gave us rags, dirty, with blood. You know what they and you know what they wanted to make us like clowns. So the small people they gave big, you know, clothes, and the big girls they gave. Small, so we were laughing when they put on those things, laughing and crying. But this was not the worst. Then they said we should go to Entlausung. Entlausung this means to a shower. A shower, this meant or to guess or a shower. So we didn't know where we're going. They put us. And I remember we were waiting, and the water didn't come out. This means that the gas will come out. So we were waiting. Said one, look at the other. We couldn't do anything. Then in one moment it started. The water was coming out. I said, oh boy, so it's good. So the water is coming out of the gas. So after a while, okay, we washed a little bit and we came out from the, and then.
Hot water, cold water?
This, we were in such a stage, so it didn't matter what was it. Then they put us in a big room, the 300. We were together for a while. We didn't have any food. So then they came and they brought us something. Oh boy. Then they said, oh, now you are going to your barrack. Very good. And you wouldn't work, only you have to stay like a quarantine. You know what is the, for this while what you staying here. So it's wonderful. Look what we went through this time, because every day was something different. One day they said they would take us. The next day we heard not us, because this is Auschwitz, they don't care who is going, other girls. But it was maybe 3 or 4 weeks. They came of us, they said, today you're going with the transport. And they have a list. And he was, you know, a big lad, and we were staying. And the men start, and they call him the Mauchemuvis, you know, like you know, the man who angel of death. So he start calling the name. But what happened from Auschwitz? The girls they knew this is a good, camp, so they came running. When he calls one name, the 10 girls will start running.
Who was the angel of death?
Who was? I think this was Mengele also, but it was far away. I couldn't. So he could. He said, "So how could I make out this 10 girls, one name, and so many?" So he said, "One of you who know all the girls should come here and tell me which is the right one." So a girl from us came. She spoke very well German. So she was there, and this was wonderful because she was telling this one, this. So the other didn't come running. Only the 300 of us. So that's how we. This was the list. What we went, and then we went to. We went to the train. And we came to, after 2-3 days, to Brindis.
Can you tell me, were there any roll calls or appels at Auschwitz that you...
Yes.
Can you describe it to me?
The roll call? During the night, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, they called us. This was September, October. This was snow flurries, and we are naked. We had to stay. And we are warming up with the bags, we were one to the other at night. So many girls got so sick, I didn't have even running nose. I didn't. And so many girls, they were very sick. Because during the night, and it was freezing, naked, we were standing.
Did you get a tattoo on your arm?
No, I didn't get, because we went just, they wanted to tattoo us. But we went, in this day, we went to, they took us out from the camp, from Auschwitz. So I didn't get the camp, no.
Did you get a tattoo in Plaszow?
In Plaszow, KL, KL I got. I told you the story, I suck it out, because it was on the very light, so I don't have the no.
Did you come across Mengele again?
Twice he made a selection in Auschwitz, twice.
Can you tell me?
I told you, he was only
right.
Squeeze my hand and that's all. And he said, go this way, and that's all. Thanks God, I didn't have too many.
Now, what happened on the day that you left? You were told that you're going to be...
Yes, so we had to come there to the place where they told us, and we went to the to the train. We went into
and
the
did
train.
They let you go without any problems?
No.
Did you see Schindler at that point?
No. Only we went in the train maybe 3-4 days and was freezing. I remember I didn't feel my legs. So I had some, shoes, they were the shoes. So she started rubbing them, because I didn't feel my legs. And this was really, otherwise I don't know what would happen. It was freezing, and we were 4 days in the train. And when we came to Brindis, so we went to the barracks, so it was already not so cold inside. But when we came there to Brindis, so no, my brothers, they were already there. They didn't recognize us. We looked like terrible.
Before you left Auschwitz, did you see anybody in the rest of the camp? Did you see what was going on in the rest of the camp?
I couldn't see too much because we were like in a all the time in a barrack. We couldn't go out even to the bathroom. If I wanted to go out, she starts hitting me, a woman. I couldn't go out, for anything.
Was this Auschwitz or Birkenau?
This was Birkenau where we were. So I didn't see anything. Only the one time I saw when we went out from the train, so I look around and I was thinking, I am not here in this world. I am already dead, because I saw people, they were not looking like people. And the camp was like, this was indescribable. Mud, everywhere you walk like in a mud. And the barracks, they look like terrible. It was impossible to describe. But then they put us in the barracks, so I didn't see anybody.
So you didn't have contact with other people?
No.
Did you do any work while you were there?
No, we were not allowed to work, the 300 girls. Because we were like in a, for a while there, so they keep us together.
Did you have your hair cut?
Thanks God, they cut a lot of girls, all the kids. Mine, they cut only this way. And I had beautiful hair, so they were envy me. They said, you look even here good. So I said, look, the good that I have hair, I am small. If I didn't have hair, I would look like a 12-year-old girl.
On the train from Auschwitz to Brinlitz, did they give you food or water? Did they open the doors at all?
They throw something in. We got when we went out from Auschwitz. I think that we got something. I don't remember. We have water and we have bread. I am sure that we didn't get, because I remember once I had some bread because I brought this from Plaszów. And they stole right away, because I looked away, and in a minute I didn't get it. Somebody stole the piece of bread.
Look. Out of your hands?
Out of my hand, yeah. Look, they were so...
End of take four. Did you ever, in any of the camps that you were in, feel so much despair that you couldn't carry on? What helped you to overcome that?
Somehow I was young, and I wanted to live. And I never, because I was thinking, maybe I survive. I don't know, somehow I had, I never had. Maybe sometimes I was very low, but mostly I wanted to live. I wanted to live through this and to tell the story. Yeah, sometimes I don't know.
Were you ever? Did you ever get ill during any of this time where you needed to go to the hospital?
No, you see, and I was so. I was not such a strong person, and I didn't have even a running nose. Never. Somehow. I had, because before the war, I used to have always trouble with my, No. Here the...
Your stomach?
Not the stomach, the... Well, I have an operation. Oh boy, this minute I don't remember.
Appendix?
Appendix, yes. But in the concentration, I didn't have any pain because I didn't eat right. So I didn't have any pain.
How did you deal with the hunger?
Look, I was never a big eater. So somehow I survived, yes.
Out of everything that you had in the camps, all the experiences, besides the time with you when your mother was taken away, what was the most difficult experience that you had?
Everything what I went through was difficult. Every day, every minute was terrible. This was the most terrible, thing what when they killed my mother. What could be worse? What could be worse than this? And you know what I was thinking? I can tell the story about my mother. How can I talk about it? And when I talk, this is a story. But I went through this. This was a person. This was my mother. And they killed her. And I am telling the story. Now,
well, your words can't really describe it. I mean...
Pardon me?
I say your words can't really describe what your feelings were.
What can I describe? To lose a mother this way?
Did any of the people, the prisoners, do anything to help each other? To make things easier?
Yes.
Or to...
Yeah. Sometimes.
Everybody
was busy with themselves. Look, you couldn't expect anything, you know. But I have there people who were very nice to me.
Can you describe anything?
Look, there was a woman. She was a... Her son was an alderman, you know, he was in the camp, a policeman, and he was terrible. So she used to come when my mother was alive, she used to come sometimes to my mother, and they were talking together. So she used to say to my mother, you see, you know what? My son, after the war, they will hang him on the first tree, because he's terrible to the people. She used to, the mother of this man, of this policeman. And it happened like this, really. After the war, right away they took this one because he was terrible.
You saw this?
I didn't see it, but they arrested him in Krakow, and I know that
Jewish
he hanged
people did.
Him. A Jewish man, yes. And they hang him in Krakow with Get. And Get also, he had a trial in Krakow. You know, and I remember I have even tickets to go to the trial. I said I cannot take it, and my husband didn't go. I didn't go. Only, you know, on the megaphones, I was standing outside the court and listening to the witnesses what they were talking about, what he did to them. You know, but I think I couldn't go in to look at him even. I could get sick.
Who tried him? Who tried Get?
And you know
the Poles,
the Jews. Yes, yeah. They
tried
him and they hang him there. Yeah.
What forms of punishment did you see in the camp, or did you experience?
All kind. They beat up people till whatever. The German, even the policemen, the Jewish policemen also, they beat the people sometimes. At one time came a girl, she was sick. They beat her up. You know, the German, they have a baton.
Yeah,
something, you know, and on the end was a little from steel, a ball. So when they hit here, and it came out here, you know, this the ball. So she was here, all over. She had the blood was coming out from this. She was sick. Yeah, I don't know if she survived. This I don't remember. What they did. Yeah.
Did any outside organizations come to see what was going on, like the Red Cross?
Yes, it was organization, what they call it, UNRWA. They sent, you know, food for us, and sometimes we got something. But who got the most? The ODED, the police, and the German, of course. And we got something, only something. You know what we got? Milk in powder. Oh, this was a treat. You know, this. And some also some soup. We got. They said this is from America. UNRWA, they sent us. You know, we should have something. But look, till it came to us, they all, you know, they make, I don't know what they did with. And then, you know, the man who was doing this, he was the one after the war. I heard about Dr. What's his name? He had a trial, a big trial, because they said that the German, he said that it was because German told him to say it is much, much more Jewish people. So they said more than they. It was really people that they ask him, what was his name, that he should say that it was so many thousands and thousands people. So they sent a lot, but it was not anymore so people. So the German, they took the food. Only a little bit we got.
So this was a German man who had to
this
say the
Jewish
numbers?
This was a Jewish name, Dr. Weichert. This was a very known man, yeah. I don't know if he was really so bad. I don't know. This, I am telling only what I heard.
So he told the numbers?
The number, a bigger number, because the German asked him, he should say a bigger number, they should send more food. You know, for the, yeah. So they took the food. And they gave us something. They should, they should think that we got the food. Okay.
So, what happened when you arrived in Brinlitz?
Yeah.
What happened? Who was there to meet this train that came in?
Who? Schindler came, and the Leipold, the one who was the SS man who took over. So he was in camp. He was out, the commander, Mr. Leipold, the murderer. Yeah. He wanted to kill us, you know, maybe later on.
Now tell me
to,
now.
To the end, you know, when the end came and they know that the war is almost over, so he asked the men from our camp, they should make graves for us because he wants to kill us all and, you know, finish us off. But Schindler was thinking, oh, we have to do something. So what he did, he gave the men weapons. And I don't know, somehow he managed that
the
Jewish people got, and he said, if he would start something, you should shoot and do whatever you can. You should not give up, so like, you should do something. But thanks God, it never came to this. Because it happened in our camp, was a very able man, and he make out, you know, he forged a paper. On the paper, it said that he has to go to the, because it was the war, and it was not far, he has to go with all the men. It was 40 men who was watching us, and he was the one who was the commander.
Leipold.
And he should go to the war. They asked him to go to the war with a man leaving us. And he got the order. He forged a paper, and he got one day the paper, and Schindler told us. He will get the paper, and so we will know what he was not sure if he would, you know, obey the order. But he obeyed the order. He went out. He took all the German who were watching us, and he put other older men, you know, were not so he went out. So Schindler said, "Now you are free, but you have to stay in the camp. You cannot go out. You have to stay." And a few days later, you know, the German, you know, surrounded. So we went. We didn't go for a death war, you know, like the from other camps. We were staying all the time till the end.
So when you got to Brinlitz, Schindler was there to meet you?
Yes.
And then, and your brothers?
Yeah, they didn't recognize us. The brothers couldn't recognize us. But then...
Why couldn't they recognize us?
Because we looked so terrible. We had clothes, you couldn't... terrible. We looked like, you know, masquerade, from a masquerade party. Yeah.
And then you went into barracks? Were there barracks there waiting
yes,
for you?
Yes, right. We had separate barracks. Clear.
Did you have blankets or did you have a separate
yes,
bed?
But in the beginning it was not so easy because it was not so prepared, everything, right? But after we got the beds and we had everything, and it was clean. And, yeah. And the men were separate and we were separate, of course. But we were in Brinlitz, we couldn't go out. Somehow we were closed up, the women. We could go out only to the factory. We couldn't go out. We didn't know why. But after the war, we realized when we came out, we were underground. We were under, and over was grass, you know. We were like, you know, because the whole camp was underground. Yeah. Especially because, you know, and it was a beautiful place, a small village, and all surrounded with mountains, beautiful. I remember when sometimes we were out, you know, they were counting us, and it was cold, freezing, and I didn't have even stockings, nothing, only shoes, and I had to stay like this, but I didn't get a call, nothing. Yeah. Yes, yeah.
Were you working at this time?
Yes, no, we were waiting, whatever I told you the machine there, I was working, and my sister-in-law was also working, and one brother was working in the office because he had after the war he finished, but still he knows how to draw, you know. So he was in the office helping, and the other brother also. So both were working in the office, and we were working, whatever.
Now, in Plaszów, as well as in Brinlitz, did men and women have a chance to get together? Could you see each other, like, at night or after?
Yes, we could, but in Brinlitz, it was very hard, because we had, like, a wall. This was a wall. We could talk through the wall, you know? Somehow we can, but it was very hard in Brinlitz. But still, we could manage to see each other. But it was okay. It was better than in Plaszów. Plaszów was terrible. At least nobody was hitting us all the time. We're not afraid. We're sitting and going to work. And that's all. We were in the barracks. and in the camp. This was not a barrack in Vrinnitz, because this was a house. They make from the building a place where the women were. Was, I think, two rooms. Yeah, it was two rooms. And was a wall, and the men were on the other side. It was different, yeah. But we still, when he was with us, we felt a little safer, you know, that we are safe. But look, sometimes he couldn't do, you know, sometimes he couldn't do anything.
Was his wife there?
Pardon me?
Was his wife there in Brinnlitz?
What?
Schindler's wife.
Yes, yes.
When did she join
him? She was all
him?
The time, but I never saw her. She talks now so much that she was helping now. I asked my brother. I asked him, because men could walk more, they were more free to go out. So my brother said, the only thing what she did sometimes, she gave some more food. But she couldn't do anything for us. Now she's talking that she was helping out. She was a very good Catholic, you know, and she was thinking, oh, maybe because she was a good Catholic, so she, but she didn't do anything good, not bad, that's all. Whatever.
Was she in Plaszow as well?
No, I didn't, she was not in Plaszow. No, she didn't have anything to do with it, but only in Emali Warm Fabric. So she was not there also. She came maybe visiting, but she was not all the time there. No. Look.
What did you get to eat in Brinnlitz?
What did you get? I don't know. What did you get? What kind of food? This is very hard to remember. Black coffee, and this I remember, and a piece of bread, I don't know how many grams a daily, and soup. That was the look, he couldn't give us so much more, because from where? Sometimes he got, because he got, I don't know, somehow. So he gave us something more.
Did you hear any news from the outside world?
Men, yes, they could, but not we, because we were like close in. But they used to come, my brother used to come and tell us story, this and that, and, but not we. The women were closed in Brinnlitz.
How did you know that the war was coming to an end?
Yeah, it was the sign, you know, the German, they were engineers, you know, who were working in the in the factory. So they were sitting, usually they used to go and tell us, do this, do that. They were sitting, doing nothing, and sitting like this. I said, oh boy, something is the matter if they're sitting like this. And we have two Aufsehers, this means two women who were watching us all the time.
German.
German woman, like tall and strong like women. So they were, but one of them, she was a small one. She used to come over to me, I don't know, somehow she likes me. She used to ask me, oh, maybe you could you, because I have all nice hair and always I was coming myself, you know, my hair was okay. Because some women, they were walking, I don't know, I don't remember exactly. But I don't know why she came over and she said, please make my hair. So I said, of course, why not? And I make her hair, I comb her. So she used to come to me and bring me a piece of bread with butter and sugar on it. Everybody was envying me. Look, she's bringing, I said, I don't know, how she likes me, and I make her hair. One day she came and she brought me a package with how to say in English, cigarette, what is inside in the cigarette?
Tobacco.
Tobacco. She brought me a package with tobacco. Do you know what this meant? $1 million for the men. So I thank her. I said, oh, how wonderful. And I ran right away, not right away. I was thinking to mine, because they were a smoking boy, you know. So I was thinking, I will give them. They should buy bread for this, because they could get. They didn't buy bread. They just were. So I gave to them. So he said, how good do you get? I said to him that she was so nice, and she brought it. Oh, boy, she was so nice. But look, she was too nice, so they took her away. This one, she was too. And the other was the witches. Oh. Yeah.
Did they do anything to you?
No, no, they didn't hit us. No, no. Not in Schindler's camp. No, never. No. One time I got a beating, you know, in a classroom. One, a tall one and so big, she came over to me and she said to ask me, because I had, you know, read, you know, from nature, not that I was painting, you know, my cheek. So she came over and she said, bist du gemalt? This means, are you, you know, if I make myself red, you know, on the cheek. I said, no. So she took her hand and she gave me her, and she hit me. I was not, all right.
Yes. So you knew the war was coming to an end because these people
they
started...
Yes, they were sitting so, with their heads down. So, and besides this, you know, there was a radio, and men could hear, because so one had, you know, I don't know if they had a radio, if somebody had a radio. Somehow they got news, one to the other, you know, if somebody knew, they were telling to the other, so everybody knew that something is going on and the war is coming to the end. Mm-hmm. So we were waiting, waiting, waiting. And one day came Schindler, he took us all together and he said, the Germans surrounded, so the 8th of May, now you are free. This was the end.
And where were the Germans that were the guards in the camp?
They went away, because I told you that they got this order to go, and when they left only the very old ones. So we were not afraid of the one, because we could, you know, so they were not dangerous, the one who left, who were with us. So when this came, so right away they ran away, those one who were still with us.
Wait, when did Schindler tell you this? Was it in the morning, the night?
This was in the morning, 8th of May. This was May, when the Germans surrounded, officially, they surrounded. So he came, the war is over, they surrounded, and you are free. That's what she said. Oh, one thing, he was very smart. He said, don't run away, don't go any place, don't go out from the camp. Because they are shooting. You know, it can come from any place. Stay indoors, stay inside.
So what happened? He told you that you were free?
Yes.
And then what happened to him? What happened to Schindler?
This is a good question. You know, I remember this was at night. The day, in the morning he said we are free. At night, nobody was asleep. We were in the factory and he came in and he said, please, now you have to help me, because now the Czech people, they wanted to kill me, because they said that I was helping out the German, that they should, because the German took over this part of Czechoslovakia, that I was helping the German, and they wanted to kill me. Please, I wanted to run away, because we were thinking that Schindler will be with us all the time. He said, I cannot stay with us. I have to run away, otherwise they would kill me. And so some of the, they didn't want the Jewish people, you know, because they said, one woman said, now I am free and now I have to go out. I don't know what would happen to me. But still they went, maybe 10 people. They had, you know, trucks and cars. And they, a few, and the German, you know, the engineers who were working in the factory, they went with him, and he took only because he had, boy, but then I went there and to see what he has, what kind of clothes he has. Like in a department store, you go to a department store, you see so many men clothes and shoes and everything. They said, go and look what Schindler, how he was dressed, what he had. And I went in, said, what? One man he meet, and the, also his wife, like in a department store, so many clothes, and we were in racks, and we were so he put on, they put on what the prisoner were wearing, in stripes, they put him, because he was afraid to go out, they should recognize him. And he went with the, you know, with the Germans or with the Jews, and he went away. Oh, he took on the, they told me, a hat with diamonds. What he, you know, people, whatever they had, they sold to, he bought from the people, or he got somewhere. So he had only the diamond, and he went away. That's what I had. I was not there.
End of tape 5. Can you tell me what you said? He had a hat with diamonds.
Yes.
Uh-huh. A hat that was covered in diamonds, or it
no, no. He had in this hat, you know, that's what they're telling me. I was not there. That he, because some people they have something, and they need for bread, so they gave like we had something, you know, from my mother had earrings, so we sold not to him, to the banker. We got some money. So he, you know, collect some probably from the people who were there, and they need money for food, for anything. If they had something, they sold. Yeah, and that's what I heard, that he took whatever, only the diamond, and he went away.
Now, who helped him to escape?
Some people from our camp. Some, you know, Jewish people. Yeah, they
did
went
you know
together.
Them?
Of course I know, but not by name. I wouldn't, not one name I remember. No,
did
I
you have to wear blue and white striped clothing like Schindler? Like what Schindler went out of the camp in?
Yes, I was wearing.
The blue
this
and
was
white
not
stri-
blue and white. This was stripes, you know, white and some, I don't know the color. Some, you know, this is the only
the
thing what
clothes.
I had. I didn't have any clothes. I didn't have. Besides this, when it was, you know, I told you about the story about the, what went down the airplane. So everything burned down. I didn't have anything. They brought some clothes from Plaszów because we were naked. We didn't have anything to wear. So whatever I got, so I had to, then we had the stripes, you know, some clothes, this was. Yeah, this one he had only this. Yeah. Yeah. I didn't have anything to work. When I came to Krakow, I went to the place, you know what, they gave me something because I didn't have anything to wear.
So after Schindler left in the night, did you have a celebration to say goodbye or anything?
Yes, we had.
Can you describe what happened?
Yes, yes. This was his birthday, and we celebrate together his birthday, and we knew that he's going away. And we make, you know, around him, and I, you know, all of the workers were around him, and they brought him on the arms, the men, from his barrack, on whatever he left, I don't know where he lived, and it was in the middle, he put him down, and he make a speech, beautiful speech, and a girl, one girl was with us, you know, in Brinice. And she gave him a woman make a cake from bread. You would see how nice, beautiful people, you know, they are so talented from nothing. They make a beautiful cake, you know, it looks like a cake because this was bread. And she gave it to him. Oh, it was so beautiful, and how he talked. He knows how to, you know, to talk. He's a wonderful speaker, he was, yeah. Yeah, and people, you know, from out also, they answer him, beautiful, in German, beautiful. He was very nice, you know. Then the next day, you know, this was next day, or I don't know, this was near the end already. Oh, why I am telling you, because he said, the war is near the end, and we know that I will call you Schindlerjuden, and Schindlerjuden sind taboo, nobody can touch them, you know? So I am sure that you will survive. He was not sure, but he was thinking, I am not, because Schindlerjuden, you are, I calling my name, you are Schindlerjuden, and Schindlerjuden sind taboo. That's what he said. Yeah, this was when that was the almost the end, and then he came, you know, the end.
And then
the
he
war.
Left, and then what happened to you?
Oh, when he went, so I was in the camp. Oh, I was sick there. You know, when so I was hungry, and my brother, so they went out from the camp. We could go out, so they were looking for food. The Czech people, they were very good. They brought a lot of food to us. But my brother, one of my brothers, he said, why we should stay in the camp? Because the Russian came, and they said, why are you staying in the camp? Take over whatever you want, what apartment you want, and go in and take everything. You can go to every apartment here in the village. Take whatever you can and take, because you, when you come to your place, you wouldn't find anything. Nothing is waiting for you. But I wouldn't go to anybody's house. I would go with my brother. But my brother, other brother said, look, here is he found out there is an empty house. And I take one apartment, take the other apartment. So I took with my brother. I went to the apartment. I would never have an apartment like this. Maybe 10 rooms and furniture and clothes. So we went in. I took one room. So I said, I would not stay in such a big apartment. I took other girls. They should take another one. Then I took another couple. So it was a few people in the apartment. So I was there for maybe 2-3 weeks. So of course I have to eat, we had to eat something. I look, I see a room full of food. Shelves around, and on the shelves, whatever I need, in all kinds of jams, all kinds of food. One thing was not meat. We could, you know, meat couldn't stay there because it would get spoiled. So I said to my brother, go out and buy. I give you something from this and make a change and buy a chicken, something, so I will cook. And he went out and he brought a chicken, but a chicken. So I said, what would I do with a chicken? I wouldn't kill it. So in the apartment was a man. He said, I am a sheikhet. You know what is this? And I will kill, you know, in a Jewish way, you know, kosher. And we were laughing. And he did. So I cooked the chicken and we have food and I cooked. And so it was, I tell you, wonderful, because other people, they start eating too much and then they got sick and they died. But I didn't want my brother. I gave him in small, you know, he was hungry, he would eat a horse. I said, you cannot eat so much. So he was not sick and I was not sick after that. But then I got sick because I ate normal and with my, you know, appendix, it started working out and I was so, sick. I had pain, it's terrible. I thought that I have to go for the operation. So I said, I am not going any place. And I lay maybe 3 days in bed there. And I got better. And after maybe maybe 4 weeks, they make, the people in camp, a train. We should go all together to Krakow. And they, a train they have, but they have to make it, put it together. We should get go. And one day they said they have everything ready. And one day we went to the train. And it took, of course, a few days till we came to Krakow with my brother, with the other brother. We came
whose house
back.
Was it that you were in?
Pardon me?
Do you know whose house it was that you were in?
In what house?
In whose house? What was the... Where
oh,
were the
house, yes, this is a good question. When we were there, so, you know, you look around. I was not curious to, but one, I was looking and there was a desk. And I couldn't open the drawer. So I said to my brother, open the drawer. Probably there is something very important. So he tried and he opened. When we opened, then we saw to whom belonged the apartment. This was the mayor of the whole, the village. And he had so many from Hitler. Because he was very, very good, for Hitler, and he gave him
a recommendation.
That he did something wonderful for Hitler's, yes. So, you know, that he was, because...
He was honored.
Honor, yes, this. The biggest honor what he got. So this was in the drawer. And one day, I was there, and I was alone. Nobody was in the apartment. Everybody went out. It was beautiful. It was May. And... So I was in the apartment because I was cooking. Somebody was knocking. I went to the, so I said, who is this? And the one was start crying and crying. Please give me, say, I have some clothes because I sold for a baby, small things. Give me, I have nothing. Give me, please. I was not thinking I shouldn't give it to her. Why should I give it? I should come out and give her a punch on the mouth. So she was crying, and I went and I gave it some, of the clothing. Then, I don't know who said to somebody, Mr. Banker came. He was also in the apartment. She came and she said, "Did you give the woman some clothing?" I said, "No, what?" She was so crying. Oh, she started yelling at me. She said, "Why did you give it to her? What, you don't remember what they did to our children?" I was very, you know, upset that I did this. No, I did this, so what can I do? That's how it was.
So then you went on the train back to Krakow?
To Krakow.
And what happened when you got back? Did you go back to your old apartment?
Yes, I went, and the woman was nice to me. She wanted to give me one room, because we have a big apartment. And the furnitures were there. Everything was there, our furniture. So she said, "If you want it, I can give you one room." I said, "Thank you." I didn't to stay there in the apartment. I said, "No." And I didn't want to have, somebody gave me another, not in the same place. I went to another place. I got in another place, an apartment. This was a building, three buildings, my uncle's buildings. He was the owner of the building, and I got there, a nice room. And I was there with my brother, till I went out from Krakow.
Now, when you went back to your apartment, did you take anything from your apartment? Did photographs were there or anything?
No, what can I take? Did the furniture were? No. I was too upset even to think about it. I wanted to run out right away. The memories, what I had.
Now, in your uncle's building, where was your husband at this point?
I was not married yet. But after I was there in a short time, a few months, and I met my husband. We married. And we didn't take another apartment. My brother moved out. He had another apartment. And we were staying because we were thinking to go any way from Poland. We didn't want to stay in Poland. So we were for a while there. But still, it took maybe 5 years because my husband got back his business. He had a wholesale place, a very big business. So he was in the business, and he said, "I am tired. I have to stay and rest for a while." He went through so much.
So he got back his business?
His business, yes. Yes, it was very good business. So I lived very comfortable after the war there. Very comfortable till we decided to go out. It was Aliyah to Israel. So we went out to Israel.
Why did you leave? Why didn't you stay?
Because all the people, all the Jewish people, they didn't want to stay in Poland. Only a few, very few. But mostly, they came back, for a while. But you could see it was impossible to live in Poland with the Polacks. They were impossible. They were anti-Semites. They killed, after the war in Kielce, so many people they killed, 50 people or more. Yeah. And also in Krakow, also I was with my husband in a place where only Gentile peoples used to live. So I was just in a different place, like in a different city. But my husband had this store in a different place. So he was in the store, and he went out for lunch to a restaurant nearby. And a bunch of Polacks came over. My husband told me this. Almost they killed him. A bunch of the Polacks, they came and start yelling, "Ridley, this," and they start hitting him and his man who was working for him. And then he said, "In 1 minute, I saw two Russian officers. They came over and they were asking, 'What happened here?' So my husband told them, they came and start hitting him. So they said to him, right away, they told to the people, 'Go this minute,' and they, they are afraid, the Polacks. Otherwise, they would kill them.
So the Russians were good?
Yes. Look, they did. Of course, they were good. Wonderful. Yeah.
How did they treat the people who were still inside Brinlitz when the Russians came?
Oh, they were very nice. They used to keep us together. They used to talk to us. Very nice. They told us, go to whatever apartment, wherever you want. Take whatever you see, whatever you want. Because when you come to your city, you wouldn't find anything there. Nothing is waiting for you. You are naked. You don't have anything. But who can? We were so down. Who had the strength even? Besides this, we are not. I am not, and my brother wouldn't go to any place to take. You know, some people they went. They took this. They took this. No.
But so there were no Russians that were crazy who tried to rape the women.
Yes, that's what I heard. Yes. They raped. Yeah, they raped the Jewish girls. Yeah,
at Brinlitz.
Not in Brinlitz, not in the camp. They wouldn't dare, but whoever went out from the camp, and you know so. One time, I remember, Russian came to the apartment where I was, but he was very nice because I was with my brother, so I don't know what would happen if he was not there. But my brother was always next to me. He was all afraid always.
Now, what agency helped you to leave Krakow?
To leave Krakow?
Yes. Who helped you to leave Krakow, to make arrangements for you to go away from Europe?
I went with my friend to Warsaw, mm-hmm. and we got the passport there. We have to sign that we are not anymore Polish citizen. We have to resign from Polish, you know, and we got the passport to go out from Poland. We went, you know, very like, yes. We went to.
And where did you go from Krakow?
It was an Aliyah to Israel. So we went to Aliyah with other people. And we went to Gdańsk, you know, because my husband, it was very hard to liquidate the store. So we were waiting till the end, till he could do. But in the end, he threw out the keys. Says, I cannot do anything. And we went. So we went with a ship, a big ship. It was terrible. It was on the ship maybe 1,800 people. We went all over the world till we came to Israel.
What year was this?
1950.
What do you mean you went all over the world?
No, because the ship was from Gdańsk, you know, making around the whole, you know.
Western Europe. I know,
on the map I would show you how we went through the whole Mediterranean, we went to the, till we came to Israel. It took us, I don't remember, maybe 2 weeks. It was terrible.
So when did you get married? What year?
A year after the war, 1946. Yeah. Yes.
And then what date did you arrive in Israel?
We went out, I remember the October, I think, November, I think. We went out from But when we arrived, maybe 2 weeks later, we were in Israel. This was the beginning. This was the worst time in Israel.
Was this is 1950? Was it in the summer?
1950, yes.
The summer, the spring?
This was winter time, because this was going through the winter, because we went out from Poland was September, October. November, yes. So we were there Yeah. There was last month of winter was very cold. Then, you know, we were 3 years, almost 3 years, yes.
And then how long were you in Israel for?
We were in Israel and was very, this was a very hard time in Israel because this was after the war. You couldn't get food, even for money. And my brother, one of my brother, were in Israel. He came out from Poland because he finished, you know, the schooling, the polytechnicum, and he went out maybe a few months before us. And he right there, he got a job as an architect. So when we came with the ship there, we couldn't go out because it was Saturday. Saturday we had to stay. So he came with a small ship to us and he said, you know, he was talking on the, he said, here are camps, you can go to a camp here in Israel, but it's terrible. If you can afford to go to a hotel, go better to a hotel. We did a wrong thing because we went out and we went to a hotel he took. It was terrible because in the hotel we couldn't get even in the room. We had to go for it. Breakfast, for lunch, for dinner, to the, you know, restaurant. And the food was terrible because it's no, you know, you couldn't get anything. So it was very hard, but it was better in the concert, because he said, the camps are terrible, only they don't shoot you. Then we went, because we have friends there, we went there to visit them. So we found out it was not so terrible. Of course it was better, we had a nicer room, you know, than in the camps. Okay, it was okay. Then we got an apartment, okay. So we were there almost 3 years in Israel.
Did your husband work there?
Yes, I was working, and my husband was not working. He couldn't, because it was very hard for him. We had some little money, so.
What were you doing?
I was working in a place, they were knitting, you know. Somebody recommended me, she said, go there, you will find, because I didn't know, you know, Hebrew, nothing, not one word. So the lady, somehow she liked me, so she said, okay, I will show you. And I start working. And I was working till we went to America. I was working there.
What made you come to America?
This is a good question. Because my husband didn't want to go to America. He said, wife, we should go out from our country. So, and one thing I have to tell you, on the ship when we were, there was a couple. She was Jewish and he was a real German. But she survived through him. The German took her and he put her somewhere that she survived, and they were married. So he was a German, but still he came with her to Israel, and he was in Israel. And he went, once we met him, and he said that he went for an ulpan. You know what is an ulpan? And he was studying Hebrew. He said, if I am in a country like a German, I have to know the language. He went there. And one day, we had already papers to go to America. We met him, and he said, so did you learn already? He said, I speak already Hebrew, the German said. So did you learn? My husband said, no. He said, how come? Why did you didn't go to Ulpan? So my husband said, because we are going to America. He said, what? From our country, you going to America? We were so surprised. A German, a real German, and he could change so much. He was, yes, he went to, he learned Hebrew, and this was his country. No?
End of tape 6. Jetti Rosenzweig. When you got to America, where did you go?
The first place we went, because I had to keep two brothers. And my why we went from Israel here? Because my husband had one brother who survived from the whole family, and he was here because he married American woman, so he was here in America, in Connecticut. So my husband said, in this time, now maybe he would think different. In this time he said, I wanted to meet my brother. How could I see him? After so many, 15 years he didn't see him. So we will go to America. So, you know, he was were starting, you know, the papers. When we were in Israel, we should have a visa from, but in this time it was very hard to get a visa, because, you know, was the two, what they killed, the espionage with the, you remember those, I don't know, Rosenbaum, no, you remember what they were spying for the Russian, so they didn't give out for maybe 2 years visas for anybody. So we couldn't get a visa to come here. So we were staying in Israel. Then after, I don't know, it happened that somebody, maybe I shouldn't talk about it because it's too a long story. My husband went in with somebody to a, you know, business. He bought a business with somebody. In this time, and we were always thinking to go to, you know, to come here to America. But he couldn't stay in doing nothing, so he bought this business, and he was in the business. And one day came, and he couldn't get the visa. So I was working, and he was in the business. One day he told me, a woman came in, and she said, who is it? Before was somebody else here. Where is the man? So my husband said, this man went, he went out somewhere, I don't know, to Canada. And he said to her, and I also think to go, because I wanted to be together with my brother, to America, but I cannot get the visa. So she looked at him, she said, you cannot get the visa. I will find out for you. So my husband right away saw her somewhere. She was the first secretary of the council, American council. And the next day she came and she said, you have the visa and you're going out this and this and day, everything she told. Boy, we got so excited. And now he was in the business. So then he, you know, it was a lot, you know, we had a lot of trouble. But still, we went out.
So what date was this that you came to this country?
January the 1st, right. 1953. This I remember.
Now, when you got here, did you discuss with anybody your experiences?
No, one time I told you with this one, I had the interview, but this was not such a good one. Because she said, tell me the story. I didn't know which story to tell. I said, I have a million stories. How can I tell you a story?
Before we finish off, is there anything that you can think of that I haven't asked you, or anything you'd like to say that I haven't asked you?
This means I don't remember anything. I think I talk too much.
Okay, I just want to ask you, when you saw this Schindler movie, did you know that this was going to be made? Did you know that this...
No, I didn't know. They were talking for years about it. But I didn't know that. One time I remember they said, they're going to make the movie. This is what I heard. How was the movie made? And I heard about the man who was, you know, he had everything. This man who was talking to, I don't know, to whom? To the man who was Spielberg. And told him the story, how it was. He said, look, nobody can say exactly how it was. It was very hard. And I think he was not in the beginning with Schindler. He was not. But still, he made the best what he could.
How did you feel when you saw the movie for the first time and you saw yourself in the movie? And
I was numb. I was numb. I didn't know what was going on. I was with two friends. They were crying, and I was sitting like I didn't know what was going on. Then the first time, then I went the next, you know, one time more. So then I was thinking, okay, now I can look at it. It is a movie. Because I have friends, they said, I cannot go and to watch it. I said, this is a movie. I went through this. And still, I wanted to see what I went through. And they couldn't go and see it. I don't know. Some people, they look.
Do you think that it really represented what your experiences were? Do you think
not everything. Look, they cannot show everything. Some places they show exactly. Look, they are, it's a big difference, but still good that they make the movie. Very good. They were, the main thing, they were showing Schindler, that he was really, really, we survived because of him. Whatever they said to them, they said, whatever, we survived because of him. This is the only thing what I can tell.
What do you think in the movie was the most well-presented part, the part that you thought was really excellent?
Which part?
Yes.
With Amon Gett, how they were showing he was in his play, in his apartment, he went out in the, you know, and he was shooting to the people, you know. This was exactly how I remember.
That was every day?
Every day.
So you felt him watching you all the time?
Look, I was not, if I would be near him, I wouldn't be here. I know about it, but I was not there. I know the building, and I know where he could be, but I was not there. If I would be there, I would be dead.
Do you have a message for future generations? That you would like, if you would like to tell something about the Holocaust that could live after you?
What can I say? It shouldn't happen again, because this is the most terrible thing what could happen to Jewish people. Through the whole history, did you hear something that every day they should thousand people take and guess them and kill them? Did you hear anything in the history? We have a long history, Jewish people, they have. But they never was like this. They could do something terrible, but not, things like this, I never heard something like this. Could any living person do to the other person something like this?
Thank you very much for sharing this with us.
Thank you. Okay. My mother's name is Zofia Zissel Zuckerman, maiden name Zimetbaum, and my father's Josef Hirsch Zuckerman. And my eldest brother is Mojżesz Juda Zuckerman, engineer. And next to him is my brother, Israel Zuckerman, accountant. And next to him is Henry Chaim Zuckerman. Also, I don't know how to call this, a bookkeeper. And then the youngest brother is Isaac. Isaac, I don't know in English, Zuckerman. He was an architect engineer. That's all. And me, little me.
Where was this picture taken?
In Krakow.
Before the war?
Before the war, of course, but I don't remember the year. This I cannot remember.
How old were you?
Here on this picture, maybe 8, something. I don't know. I don't know. Yeah, I don't remember at all. Okay? Here is a picture of my brother, eldest brother, Mojżesz Juda Zuckerman, who he used to work in a big factory. He was the director of the whole factory. And this was a celebration of something. I don't remember exactly what it was. So those are the people who used to work before the war in Krakow, yes. This is my aunt. This is my mother's sister, the eldest sister. Next to her is a son of her. Next to him is my mother. And then is my father. Then is another sister also of my mother. And this is my brother and me. That's all.
And who are the people sitting?
Where? Where is it? Oh, also a cousin, yes.
Taken.
This was taken in a kurort, a summer place, Krynica Zdrój.
In before the war?
Before the war, yes. Of course, you can see. Sorry. This is the same place, the same kurort, Krynica Zdrój. And this is my aunt one, and the other was also an aunt. And a cousin next. And this is with the beard. It's a husband of my aunt. And there is also a cousin. And this is all, four people, no? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yes.
Did any of them survive?
No, not one. Okay, this is one brother, and this is a neighbor, and this is another brother.
What are their
names? Oh, the brother is the eldest brother, Moises. And then is another brother is Henry, and then is the youngest. This is Isaac, and this is a neighbor in the. And then there is my father also in the back.
And where was this taken?
I don't remember exactly. Somewhere in an apartment. I don't know.
Before the war.
Before the war, oh yeah. After the war, oh yeah.
Okay,
this is my eldest brother, Moises Zuckerman, Henry, and Isaac, and this is a neighbor. The woman. And who else? Nobody else.
And where was it taken?
It was taken probably in the apartment.
In Krakow?
In Krakow, yes. Krakow, right. This is from my wedding, the picture. This is me, this is my husband in the middle.
And what was his name?
My husband's name is Yehuda Rosenzweig. My husband's name. And to the right, yes, this is a friend who is a rabbi's daughter. She is in Brooklyn. A rabbi. This is a, you know, it's a whole story. I didn't tell the story. Her husband on the picture, Schindler's picture, they were showing how Get wanted to kill him. He was a rabbi, her husband. And he couldn't kill him because, you remember, this was the story of her husband, the Rabbi Levertov. And this is my best friend. She's still in Brooklyn. She is alive. And next to her is my brother, Isaac. And then to the right is my sister-in-law, who was with Schindler, with me, this one. And next to the right, to the left, is my brother Israel. And next to him is his wife. And next to him is my brother, who was with me, and which is his wife, with Schindler, this brother, Henry Heim Zuckerman.
And
this was taken after the wedding, you know, in Krakow. And next to him is also a man, a relative. This is not important. Yeah.
And this was what year?
Wait a minute, I have to. 46. 46 after, yeah.
Now, which was Rabbi Levitov's wife?
This one. On this side.
The right, extreme right hand.
This one. Next to, I am here and she is here.
The extreme right hand.
Yes, yeah. The rabbi, she's also a rabbi's daughter, a rabbi's from all the rabbis. That's I am also so familiar with the rabbis, the Frankers. Very
and
near.
Her husband survived?
No. He survived Schindler, but it happened as a terrible thing. He was in the one day, he was Friday evening, he went out with all, friends from Davenen, and a car came over and killed him in Brooklyn. Terrible thing. I went to the, of course, to the funeral. Ah. This is giving out this this paper when they surrounded, the Germans surrounded, and the Germans went out and saw the. Jewish people wanted, we should have some, in the camp, we should have some papers from where we coming. If we going somewhere, we should have some paper. So they were giving out those papers, our name and everything, that we were in Brinice, in this concentration camp, that we were there. So this was the paper, what we got. This was the, this was giving out in Brinice when the German, the war was over. And we wanted to, we could go wherever we want after the war. So we should have some paper because we didn't have anything, any papers. This was the only thing what I had. This was in the camp. They were giving us out.